Well, another day, another congressional seat flipping from red to blue. Just adding to Donald Trump's anguish as the House slips out of his party's grasp. Bye-bye, Devin Nunes, Committee to Protect the President. NBC News has now called the race in California's 45th. Democrat Katie Porter has defeated two-term Republican incumbent Mimi Walters. Democrats have picked up a net 36 seats in the House of Representatives, with five House races still to be called. And with no rallies and locker-up chants to keep him distracted, Donald Trump is isolated and growing more furious by the day. And the worst Republican midterm losses since Watergate are just one reason he's so miserable. Frank Rich writes in New York Magazine, it has belatedly dawned on Trump that A, he lost the midterm he thought he won, B, the Robert Mueller investigation has moved faster than his efforts to thwart it, C, any of his legislative fantasies, notably the funding of his border wall, are doomed, and D, and his pouting in Paris elevated his international image as a buffoon to a whole new level of notoriety. Trump plans to travel to California on Saturday to view the damage caused by the catastrophic wildfires ravaging the state. 74 people have been killed in those fires. More than 1,000 people are missing. And these are new numbers just announced a few minutes ago. Of course, the president's initial instinct was to side with the fires, blaming the deadly wildfires on poor forest management. And ahead of his visit to California, he doubled down on that bizarre message in an interview airing on Fox News Sunday.
I was watching the firemen the other day, and they were raking areas. They were raking areas where the fire was right over there, and they're raking trees, little trees like this that are nut trees, little bushes that you could see are totally dry, weeds, and they're raking them. They're on fire. That should have been all raked out.
What about the argument?
You wouldn't have the fires.
What about the argument it's climate change, that it's drier, it's hotter, and that that's contributing to it?
Maybe it contributes a little bit. The big problem we have is management.
Wow. Joining us now is Tony Schwartz, co-author of Donald Trump's best-selling book, The Art of the Deal. And Tony, you know, one of the kind of seeming features, if I may, of Donald Trump's personality is that he's always been able to kind of BS his way through things and sort of seem to be successful and just get through it because there was never any deep scrutiny of his claims. He could just say, I'm the most successful businessman in the world, and no one really needed to check it because why would they bother? It feels like this job is something he doesn't know how to handle the fact that the things he said actually do get deep scrutiny, and he's sort of exposed. Is that unfair?
No, I think he is at a particularly difficult moment because absolutely central to his identity is I'm a winner. And even if it's based on a mountain of lies, he has been able to make that case all the way through even significant parts of his presidency with the support of two Republican branches of government.
Sure.
Now he looks at a world in which, first of all, from the perspective of the midterms, he's a loser. I'm a loser is what's going through his head. Now, actually, it may not be going through his head. What's going through his head is rage. And the rage is my identity has been destroyed. Right. And so I think if he didn't hold the future of the world in his hands, you could almost feel sorry for him right now, because imagine the stress that this guy is under. He believes he can't trust anyone. I would say that would very easily include his own family, but his vice president, who's the most sycophantic vice president in the history of the world, even he is apparently not trusted by Trump. He is facing these Mueller charges. He is facing a Democratic Congress that he knows is going to go to and investigate him. And that is overwhelming. And I do think that he is in a period right now, a moment of really great fear. I think that fear is such that he's never a good thinker, but he literally can't think straight right now.
Yeah.
And I think the delusion and the paranoia, and those words are easy to throw around, but I do believe he's deluded, and he deeply believes that the world is out to get him.
Yeah, and I mean, on the delusion part, I mean, if somebody is at such great risk of exposure, putting himself out there and essentially saying the midterms are about me, these are my midterms, and making it such that if Republicans lost, that he would be branded with loss. And now they have lost. This is the most catastrophic loss since Watergate. Democrats trounced Republicans in those in the House races and held Republican losses to maybe a net plus one. So he did lose. But it seems that, to your point, he's the one who took that risk. No one told him he had to make the midterms about him.
Well, and he obviously believed that this was not going to happen.
Yeah.
And in fact, he continues to say it didn't happen, even though it did happen.
Right.
And he's today is tweeting that, you know, it was a historic win for the Republicans and he did great. Well, you know, from what planet? You know, what I'm hoping is that the Democrats are not simply focused, although I think they should be somewhat focused on investigating many of the things that have been left untouched for the last 2 years that Trump has done. There are plenty of them. But that they're also talking about, first of all, character. We've lost character in all of this. Trump has dragged down the level at which and the degree to which we take seriously the issue of character. In other words, what do you believe in? Not just the what, which has become the focus of attention, particularly in the Republicans, is whatever it takes, whatever I have to sacrifice, however I have to sell my soul, that's okay, so long as I get the end I want. Certainly true of the massive evangelical support for Trump. Those are people who presumably are deeply invested in their values, and they've traded them for the small number of issues that he seems to be supportive of.
But some of them are not small. I mean, we're thinking of the Farr nomination, the Thomas Farr nomination that's coming up. I mean, we're talking about lifetime seats on the judicial bench of people who have really extreme views. We're talking about massive voter suppression. I mean, there have been real consequences for real people who've been denied their rights to vote. I mean, for those poor military people who are now down on the border eating rations instead of Thanksgiving dinner with their families, doing absolutely nothing at the border, waiting for a caravan on foot, 1,000. People are actually suffering. So I guess the question would be, what, in your view, could be done to mitigate the harm that Donald Trump could do in this state?
Well, I think some amount of attention has to be focused on what could be done, not what could be done to Trump, which certainly that will play out. And I believe, as I've said for a long time, that Mueller is going to come up with a raft of indictments that make it clear he committed crimes. But in addition, we've got a catastrophic, world-threatening crisis with the climate. We've got and a level of income inequality right now that is unprecedented. And you look at this story about Facebook and all of these, you look at Jeff Bezos sitting there with $160 billion, $159.8 of which neither he nor five generations of his family is ever going to be able to spend. What about taking on some of those issues in an affirmative way? Mm-hmm. What about not simply talking about how bad Trump is? I do believe that the Democrats, in order to really prevail in 2020, have to create a narrative that has an addressing of these critical problems at the heart of it.
Yeah, absolutely. While mitigating the harm of some individuals, we're going to talk later in the show about, you know, a very real human being named Fethullah Gulen who could be in quite real jeopardy because this isn't, you're not protecting someone who is living under the protection of a green card. It's pretty scary. We're going to talk about that. Tony Schwartz, it's always a treat to talk to you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thanks for checking out our YouTube channel. Subscribe by clicking on the button below for more from The Last Word and the rest of MSNBC.